First of all, thank you so much for having me here. I'm not a person who does this very normally, I must say. I'm much more, as Anita just told you all, I'm very much a behind the scenes kind of worker. I'm an organizer. As a film editor, my main job is not to be present. I think a good film editor is somebody who effaces themselves completely. So basically that is my background, so I'm not, but I just wanted to talk about one or two things which I thought were important, especially for y'all who are in a field that I know is so directly connected to society and where y'all are contributing so directly to society that often we are asked, why does the government of Kerala spend so much money on a film festival? What is the need for a film festival? Why is there so much investment in culture? Why is there so much investment in art? Is it the job of the government to do this? These are questions that are often asked, and often I sort of reflect on this and I think, why do we do this? Why are we here? What is our role, etc.? So out of these thoughts, I thought I would talk to you. I'll start a little bit with my own personal experience of my life and my journey a bit to just tell you why I think what we do is crucial. I think we are the game changers. I think artists are the game changers. When I say artists, I'm not talking about painters only. I'm talking of people who express what they see, what they hear, whether it is a poet, whether it is a writer, whether it is a filmmaker, because I certainly believe film is the art form of the 20th century. So I feel that you can do away with everything in society, but you cannot do away with art, because art is what actually what nature wanted us to be. And when you look at nature and see how beautiful it is, you realize that art is the most important thing that also makes us human, makes us human beings, and therefore it is something we have to hold on to very hard. So I will talk about some artists whose work I will show you. I will show you as a spectator how we look at it, as a maker what it does to you, and just generally some thoughts about this. So, I mean, I was born a woman. I was born into a fairly upper middle class family in Delhi, grew up in Delhi. Being a woman at that time never was a disadvantage. I grew up, for some reason, my parents never thought of us as, I was never a girl or a girl child. We were brought up to be bold, confident, face the world, contribute. So this was, I think this was a kind of urban experience of growing up, good education, all of us growing up together. And also, it was the 70s. I don't know how many of you knew the 70s were, after 1968, there was a great change that happened in the world when the students in Paris were revolting, and there was this whole new energy that was happening in the 70s among young people. And I was lucky to be part of that, and I was going to college and so on. But it was more a kind of lifestyle kind of thing that we were looking at. We were wanting to dress differently, we were wanting to think differently, etc. And then suddenly the emergency came in India. And I came from a family that was very ordinary in terms of not any politics or anything. So we were not affected, but I was friends with people who were very affected, journalists, filmmaker, parents. And suddenly, there was this dark cloud that descended on our beautiful skies. We were growing up happy, happy-go-lucky kids with all the best things happening, and suddenly this emergency happened. And I remember then, you know, we were all wondering, listening, phone calls, picking up at night, people were being arrested, there were all these, you know, Hitler-like notices all over the place and all that. At that time, in my college, I met a filmmaker called Anand Patavardhan. So Anand said to me, I made a film and I want to show that film in your college. Now, I was in a girls' college, one of the top girls' colleges now, and at that time, Lady Shri Ram College. And it was quite unimaginable. And those days, it was risky. But in any case, I decided with some friends, we had a secret screening of a film called Prisoners of Conscience. This film was shot during the emergency, and it's called Prisoners of Conscience, and it was shot on 16mm. He had a kind of gorilla kind of camera. He was shooting underground, and that film, I wish I could have shown you the clip, opened my eyes first to cinema and what somebody telling a story well, telling it with passion, telling it with commitment, what it does. It really opened my eyes. And that I always mark as the sort of starting point of my journey into cinema. Because you understand the power of cinema, you understand the power of expression, you understand the power of somebody having something to say, the passion to say something and expressing it. So Prisoners of Conscience was banned, of course. Nobody was allowed to see it. It was about people in jails during the emergency time, and these were all top people who were put into jails, and it explores this. So this was my first sort of understanding that, you know, it's not pamphlets, it's not political pamphlets that are important as much as it is to say something that you believe in, that you have to say in a particular way. So this was my first kind of, also I understood sympathy, which I think is another thing with art, that sympathy is an underlying sort of nature of all expression, that you understand that you are, when you show something, you sympathize with it, you express it because you have a feeling to it. It's not just a mechanical reproduction. That was the important thing, that it was not a mechanical reproduction. It was something that really had the sense of an investment of the filmmaker in that. So then I read a book called The Necessity of Art. This book, and this became for me a kind of mantra for my life, that in a decaying society, which was what was happening during that time with all this clamp down and all that, and also high levels. I must remind you that in the 70s, India was not this booming, prosperous India that we are imagining today or think it is today, but it was a pretty grim situation at that time. So in a decaying society, art, if it is truthful, must also reflect decay, and unless it wants to break faith with its social function, art must show the world as changeable and help to change it. So this was my kind of understanding of my role as a person in society, that you have to reflect, you have to think, you have to see, and you have to believe that you can be an agent of change. That was very important for me. So when I go to the Film Institute, first I did theater. I worked with a very famous filmmaker, theater director called Badal Sarkar. And he was doing street theater. And then I went to the Film Institute. And I really believe that my job as a person who's going to the Film Institute is to create films, to create ideas, to put out ideas that is something I would like to be an agent of change. And this change is not out of a position of hatred, but this is a position of love. That I just extremely, I'm very passionate about my society. I'm very passionate about other people. And I really believe that my cinema has to do that. I was not, in a state of saying that I just want to make money or I want to, of course you have to do all that in life, but this for me was not the driving instinct. I think for me communication and really reaching out to people was the... And at this point, can you change the slide? Yeah. In art film school, we were exposed to so much. We were made to read, we were made to write, we were made to watch films, we were made to listen to music. And this was one painting that I don't know if you all know, this is rather a cliched painting. It's called Guernica by a famous artist called Picasso. Now this painting for me was again another point where I understood that how does a creative mind transform an experience? And that is also the important thing. How does your mind as a medium with your experience, with your background, with your thoughts, with your culture, how does it transform an experience and communicate? Now, this is supposed to be the most seminal work on the civil war in Spain. Picasso painted this as a reaction to the civil war in Spain. And if you look at the painting, it's got pain, it's got violence, it's got hurt, it's got everything. Everybody will dismiss it saying, oh, it's modern art. What do we understand? How should we understand? But the important thing is to look, to pay attention, and find what you have to find in these paintings. So this was the other lesson, that art is not something unreachable. Art is something that is actually meant for people. It is for people to see, for people to look, for people to understand. And the voice of the artist is actually the voice of the people. It is not some rarefied space, but it is the space where what people cannot say, perhaps, because often you are caught in the drudgery of life and bringing up children and making two ends meet, which is what most people unfortunately have to deal with. But there are minds that can transport this and make you aware that there is much more pain, there is much more to communicate. So this was also an important kind of story for me. There is an artist in China called Ai Weiwei. Ai Weiwei is an artist who actually first caught the attention of the world because he stood, no? He stood with a 3,000-year-old Ming vase, which is, supposed to be the biggest treasure of China, one of the biggest, all these old Ming vases. And he held it in front of the whole world and just dropped it. and it smashed. And this was like atrocious. Atrocious. People were, I mean, the Chinese were astonished. And then he made a statement saying, I am destroying this whole culture of sort of making art into something that is not reachable. This whole thing of royal patronage, this, that. He was breaking the status quo. IYY, I wish this clip was there. He is such a fantastic artist. He is hated by the Chinese government because, for example, he made a film. He made a film on an earthquake, the collapse of a building in an earthquake where hundreds of Chinese children died. And the reason they died was because the building was badly built. So he has made a film, and people just saw this film in China and they were utterly shaken by it because it was such an unnecessary thing. And he made a huge installation along the side of a building. He put hundreds of school bags of children. Just hundreds of school bags were put. And this is his way of protesting. It is the most beautiful thing to look at. He's done with pink and blue school bags. So Ai Weiwei has challenged, all the time challenged the notions of the role of the artist in society. The role of the artist in society is to constantly challenge. Why aren't you doing something? Why are people sitting quiet? Why don't you question everything? So this is one artist that I would have liked to show you this clipping, because for me, these are the things that always play in my mind with everything that one does, you know. Then there is another person I would like to talk to you. Okay, so just one more thing. I don't know if you know, in the recently concluded documentary film festival of Kerala, three films were prevented from being screened because of because of censorship issues, let's say. They did not allow us to screen it. So I always go back to artists like this, because you think that these are the people who give you energy. He has been jailed. IYY has been jailed. He's been put on. He has to go underground. He can't leave. He was slapped with huge taxes. He's made into the biggest villain of China. And he's only an artist, you can imagine. So my thing is that the state is very scared of artists. Why do they ban films? Why should they ban a film? What does a film do? So all along, you have to understand the power of these mediums is so strong. And any state is always nervous of this kind of challenge. And he has really challenged them. And I think that when this time at the documentary film festival, when we put it on YouTube and we had screenings in other places and all, my thoughts were all this, that yeah, this is what we are meant to do. We are not defying, we are in fact helping society to ask these questions. That is what our role is, not to keep quiet and say everything is good and everything is fine, but to keep asking these questions and keep challenging. I would also like to talk to you about another artist. This is a photographer from Brazil called Sebastião Salgado. Now, Salgado was a photographer. What I'm saying is how everybody uses their own means to tell stories that are different. So now if you look at these images, there are four or five images. They're just photographs. These are things we see every day. You see people in construction sites. You see people walking on the roads. These are things that you see every day. But the artist transforms these things that you think are so trivial to make you look at it again and make you think about it. And so when you see these images, it is a different experience. It is not like simply looking at that man on the road. But now when you look at the worker, this photograph will echo through your minds and make you all think. He worked in the mines of Brazil. He worked in the, you know, he worked in refugee camps. This is a migrant colony that he worked in Kenya. And it's almost, this is a road where some workers are transporting. So, so Salgado has always, for me, represented how the completely ordinary, through the mind of the artist, takes you into another world, takes you and gives you a dimension that you would never see otherwise, right? This is, I mean, when you see a sliver of light, and what is he using? Only light and some, I don't know, some digital, he was of course working on film. He is now about 80 years old. But these images will never leave you. The bodies, how they get transformed, how the, everything gets transformed. Yeah, so they arouse in us not only a sense of beauty, but also a great sense of anger, a great empathy, and almost feelings that cannot be described. It's like looking at a painting that you sometimes you cannot describe the feeling. It transports you somewhere else. Or you read a poem, it transports you somewhere else. So these photographs give you that feeling. You know, it's almost like an ethereal feeling. But what about the creator of this? So now we'll go to another. This is a painting from village women who paint in a small village in Rajasthan, in Bihar, called Madhuban. Now this is a Madhubani painting. They are women, they are very ordinary village women who work in the fields, who go and collect water, bring up children, terribly ruled by patriarchy, have no say in other things. But what they do is, on their walls, they paint these beautiful images from their own experience. So what does it do to them? For them, it becomes a way of telling the world about their own beauty, about what they see. You know, see, look at this. This is a black and white painting. Can you imagine the incredible beauty of this? It's their stories, it's their myths. It's, you know, it's a storytelling which is so exquisite. Let's see the next slide. This is a Gond painting. This is a painting of tribals in a village in Gond. Again, it's so incredible. The beauty is so incredible. This is a Varli painting. This is Varli tribes. Just show the next one. Here, these women, just look at these women. They stand in front of their walls and they paint. So what I'm just trying to come to is that from ancient cave paintings right up to today's cinema, man or the human being has had an urge, has literally had an urge to create and interpret and say and get solace from beauty. See, when I say beauty, I don't mean only beauty. I mean the inspiration is beauty. That's what I mean. I don't mean beautiful faces and white faces and all that. That's not my meaning of beauty. I mean, for somebody, this may not be beautiful at all. You know what I mean? It's rough. It's just something, but it's a form of expression that is so important. So again, I come back to the thing that man is surrounded, or we are surrounded by so much beauty that, I mean, we have, as human beings, our inspiration is only beauty. Actually, we have to, and this is the connect that we have lost today. That we are not able to make these connections. You see, when you go on a holiday and you spend 2 days looking at the beautiful hills of Ponmudi, and you miss the fact that in your garden there may be a little flower blooming, that disconnect is huge. It's not about going for 2 days and looking at this beautiful thing. The film festival is about the fact that in India, or mostly anywhere in the world today, market forces dominate the area of cinema. So therefore, today, if you go and you say, I want to see a film, you have, of course, a few Malayalam films, the films that make it. You have Hollywood films, and you have Bollywood films. You don't have films from Bengal. Bengal has about 150 films being made every year. Maharashtra has some 100 and something films being made every year. Africa makes films. Cuba makes films. Argentina makes films. Everybody makes films. But today, as a viewer, you don't have access to this other than through your own private means. Therefore, you have to be privileged to say, I have an internet connection, or I have YouTube, and I have understanding of world cinema, and therefore. So for me, the idea of the film festival is a cultural space where we are able to see the best of world cinema without the market forces deciding what you should see and what you should not see. That for me is why the film festival is so important, and that for me is why the government has to fund this, because as at least in Kerala, we really believe that there is a value that is given to this exposure which changes people, which makes people different, and therefore that cultural space is really, really important for me. So from these beautiful women who are painting this, I'll just show you some other photographs to say that, you know, what we were talking about, that we're so, so surrounded by, okay. This is also what art is, the provocation for talking about enigma and the search for sense in human life. One can do that by telling a story, writing about a fresco by Giotto, or studying how a snail climbs up the wall. So basically, it's contemplation. Art is contemplating. It gives you that space to contemplate, this world, to contemplate where you are. I think anybody who's working anywhere, whether you're in front of the computer, whether you're sitting driving a school bus, whether you're plowing a field, I think all human beings ask this question, who am I? What is this grand scheme of things? Why are we here? And I think through looking at all this, this gives you time to contemplate. There are no answers. Of course, there are no answers. But there is a space to contemplate on all this, which I think daily life doesn't allow. You're so forced to be on this conveyor belt that is hurtling you towards the end that you never stop, or you're not allowed to stop and think. And I think if you look at a painting, it just gives you that moment. It gives you, it unravels that mystery. That is the thing, that everything is so mysterious, it's so beautiful, everything has so much potential for this brain of ours, which God knows where it came from, to be able to engage with all this. And I think we lose this today when we think these are not important things, that it's only for some people, it's only for the arty types. I'm only working in a hospital. I don't need to look at it. That is not what it is. It is the human condition, and it is the human need that, and I think it comes because Because we are surrounded by it. This is a set of photographs done by a photographer called Ansel Adams, who was an American photographer. He was a landscape photographer. And I think all of us have seen these flowers in our, these leaves in our garden. But if you just look at these leaves and you just look at the way this photograph looks at it, it's transporting at a different level. Look at this. This is like a painting. We see it every day. We don't even look. This is a rose. And this is what it's about. He talks, of course, about his work with the camera. But I would say when I make a film, I don't make a film only with the lens and the this thing. But I make it with everything of myself. I make it with a commitment, with the books you have read, the music you have heard, the people you have loved. Everything goes into what you create. And I think nobody can say it better than Pablo Neruda, the greatest poet. He said that art can never be divided from your politics. Art is what defines you as a person living in society. It is not some rarefied space. It is a space of life, actually life, and what happens around you. And finally, I think this, I would like to end with this, because I would say that for me, all this is an act of love, actually. And I think the artist or the filmmaker or the musician or the painter, the writer, the poet, they bind everybody in love and not in hatred. Which is what a lot of people, unfortunately, politics, corporates, all that divide people on competition, on hatred, on territory, on difference. Whereas in the world of art, I think what it brings together is the whole. It is a binding force of love. I also wanted to, just one more thing I wanted to say, that as I sort of went along this journey and I started with Prisoners of Conscience, I just wanted to say that somewhere along the line, I realized that being a woman was quite a disadvantage. You choose to believe that everything's fine, and you suddenly look around and you notice, where are the women? There are very few women painters. I mean, I don't know if any of you can even name an Italian Renaissance woman painter. And within our own country, the way women artists were looked at were Devdasis, Mujra singers. So there was this total moral attachment that was given to women who attempted to use art in any way. Film actresses. Pretty much there was that sense when you join the film industry, everybody's thinking, oh, why does she want to join the film industry? It is an immoral industry. Somehow this morality of the woman becomes the main issue. You know, as if, I mean, you all are working, I know, in contraception, so I can say it, as if virginity is the sole reason a woman is a woman, you know, and that is what society moves to protect all the time. And for me, that became a strange kind of thinking point. That what is it? I mean, of course, I'm happy, I'm empowered, I have a child, I have a husband, I have everything. But why is it that you are looked at as if you are an odd person, that you have made a professional choice, a choice in your life that does not conform to what society thinks you should be. You know, if I had been a doctor and I was coming home late at night, it's fine. But because I'm a film editor and I come home at late at night, it's not so fine, you know. So this has been another sort of thing that has gone through my life. I don't know if it's worth sharing, but it's worth sharing because I think the next generation need not go through this. I really believe that the next generation need not go through this. I think education, culture is about us being agents of change. As he said, as IYY said, I do this so that the next generation doesn't have to. So that's it. I don't know if all this made sense, but this is what I'd like to say. Thank you. If there are any questions, please do.
As per the film paternity concern, the enigmatic nature of art film is been getting diminished day by day. And it means so the people's choice towards arts movie has been declined and moving to a commercial. That is one aspect. When I have seen movie from 1980s, so I see people, you know, even in serials, they used to have an art count of serials. It has been totally diminished. That is one aspect. Second aspect, the theater is also totally obsolete in Indian cinema. There is no importance to the theater art. That is second aspect. Third is, what is the importance of cinema in the human personality in the society, and where do the women play a role in what is the, because there's a lot of exploitations of the women in the film industries. So where do the women play a role, and how that can be protected and move forward in society?
Okay. So the first question about this whole business of art cinema and so on, I'm not a great prescriber of this notion that there is something called art cinema, but I do think that the competition is very unfair. That for example, in Kerala, we can talk about Kerala, there is an industry that is ridden by the star system, right? So if you have a star, you have enough money to do publicity, you have enough money to show 500 prints all over the city. But if you don't have, you can't. But having said that, I must say that there is a younger generation of filmmakers today who are questioning this. I don't know if you all have seen Angamali Diaries, if you have seen Mahesh and Depradigan. For me, those are films that are coming back. I mean, I don't appreciate them all fully, but I think there is a notion of coming back and understanding the form of cinema, the role of cinema, etc. So there is a change. I mean, I think there is this notion of, oh, the 70s art film were these slow, all art films are slow. But this is like I said about the painting. Modern art? Oh, I don't understand modern art. But you don't look. Have you all even tried to look? Have you tried to watch a film like that? Instead of saying, oh, it is so slow. So these are also notions that have to be re-examined. This is how the market conditions you to think in a certain way, that all films that are slow are of bad quality. So, but I think youngsters are re-questioning this. There is a revival. Lot of people are going back to the theater. We are at the most healthy time in Malayalam film industry because a lot of people are going back to the theater. And to answer your last question, I think what I said about women is not only about being a participant in the process of making, but also utter shock at the way women are portrayed. The content of cinema, I mean, it is such a deep patriarchy, it's not even funny. I must tell you that this is, of course, not true only of Malayalam cinema. You see, we all think that it is only in India, it is only Malayalam cinema. But even in Hollywood today, there is some new statistic that in Hollywood, there are only 5% women directors. 5%. In a huge industry like that, there are only 5% women who are able to make films. Because people don't invest. If you are going to make a big film, now this Wonder Woman has done some, there has been some change in perception after Wonder Woman has come. But if you are going to make a film like Jurassic Park, oh, a woman can't make a film like Jurassic Park. A woman can only make a soft romantic comedy. So there are these notions that have to be revisited. And there is a very interesting test called the Bechel test, B-E-C-H-A-L, Bechel or Bechel test, in which a film is judged on the content about women. So how many women are in the main characters? They find very few. It's always sister, husband, wife, cousin, grandmother. Then, how many times does the woman talk anything of any importance? Very low. Pass me the water, get into the car, are the children ready? That is the only conversation that is consigned to women. So these are, I mean, now there's a lot of research going into this. And in fact, now there are even awards for films that, you know, they call the Bechel Awards, where if there is a rating that is a little better than this usual process of just pushing them to the side. So yeah, it is quite upsetting. And I think we are seeing the effects in society a lot today that women... it's like a vicious cycle. You see it on film, you see it, therefore you enact it in your real life.
I have a question regarding an artist. From your perspective, what do you think, what is the fundamental necessity for an artist? Under a stressful condition like in the country like Sicily or any country like Greek, Leonardo da Vinci, when those days when Europe were under stress, such a kind of condition would create an artist, or such a sophisticated condition would create an artist?
No, I tried to say that even in a small village there is an artist. There is no need to be in a sophisticated, stressful condition. It is the basic nature of the human being to express. And I think that is what makes. But how you use this art, where you use it, that matter varies. I think it's not stressful conditions. I think we have, and I think that makes, defines us as human beings. That is for me what
the... Why the majority of the artists are coming from the South American country, something like that?
No, not South American. I have one from China, yeah. One from South America, one from Europe. Of course, you have Ansel Adams is an American photographer. So you have people coming from all over the place. There's no...
Yeah, that's right. But in countries like in India, the people do say that, okay, we don't need such a kind of things because we need other priorities used to be solved. So we don't need...
That is my question.
So why...
One priority is not over the other priority. Yes, I know this is the question. That is why I started by saying everybody says, oh, India is so poor. Why should we have a film festival? But I'm saying a film festival is as important because empowerment of the people is the most important thing. And when you empower people through art, they will ask the questions and they will get the things they have to get.
Thought came into my mind, which has been quite discussed a lot. Like... in art, you know, what we learn in school as kids starts with the language, learning of language, sciences and math. But art needs to have a certain kind of induction for anyone to understand it properly, like music. What goes beyond the popular art is what I'm telling. So don't you think that this total lack of art education when
Absolutely.
We are children is playing a role in distancing the people from art?
Absolutely. I think this is the crux of the matter, that it is not considered an essential part of any curriculum. It is not considered, I mean, visual literacy is so low in all our, we can spend days and days and going for tuition on maths and physics and chemistry, but really there is no emphasis given on the fact that if you develop these other senses, you create a much more just society. Yeah, 100% that is a problem. And I also think that when I define art, I'm also saying the art of teaching, the art of science. What is the art of science? The art of science is to appreciate the beauty of this science. I mean, sometimes when I listen to physics, I'm just mind blown. Or when you see maths and you see how things work in maths, it is phenomenal, you know. But what I'm saying is nobody's encouraged to think like that. You're only looking at the numbers, you're looking at how to solve the problem at that level. That concept of this whole, the sense of the beauty of it all, you know, when you solve an equation, sometimes I can't tell you, it's mind-blowing how physics and all this really is so utterly beautiful. And I think it's very interesting, a lot of physicists are very good musicians. There seems to be all these connections in our brain which seem to work. That mathematicians and physicists are great musicians and understand great music. You know, it's like there is some realm over there that has to be opened in our brain all the time. From when you are a child, I agree with you completely.